Find Your Purpose Now podcast. I'm so glad that you joined me today. Today, we're going to be talking about finding your purpose in your past. And, you know, talking about our past is, it can be fun. Talking about the times that we accomplished something that we didn't think we could accomplish. Talking about the times that we just barely achieved, but we did it. Maybe dragging ourselves across the finish line, but we did it. Going through a hard time and living through it, making it, just putting one foot in front of the next and continuing to go. How about doing things that were hard and we could have found the easy way out? We could have quit. We could have cheated. We could have not done it and said we did, lie about it. I mean, there are a million different variables, but you get the idea. When we look back at all the things that we've done in our lives, there are so many good clues there. When we think about the way we felt when we went through some of these things, there are some really important, I would say, juicy clues in that. That going through something, even if it's, something that, it was hard. It was a hard thing to do. But we persevered. If we think about what it took for us to make it through, for example, the kinds of things that we did to get through, these are our coping skills. What did you do? Did you have to set an alarm? Did you have to set two alarms, three alarms in order to get up in the morning? Did you have to buy a coffee pot that you can set the night before that goes off? And so the smell of freshly brewed coffee is in your house and you just are drawn to get up. Does that make you get up? Whatever it is that you had to do to get through a certain thing, to accomplish something, think about that, because whatever you did before, you can do again. The things that motivated you, maybe it was hearing from your boss, "Oh my gosh, you saved the day. Thank you so much for what you did." Or hearing, "Okay, you get the promotion," or "Guess what? We're giving you a raise." Or when you're trying to get the job and you hear, "Yeah, you're hired." Well, what did you do? What did you do on that interview? What did you do leading up to it? How did you psych yourself up? What words did you use to go through the motions? If the emotions were not great, if you had to fake it till you make it, for example, how did you do it? What did you do? What words did you use to motivate yourself? What pictures, what ideas, what daydreams, what journal entries? What was it that you've done in the past that worked for you? Really think about those things, because those same things that motivated you before or something similar will motivate you again, because what worked before for the way you're wired will work for you in the future. Now, you might have to tweak it a little bit, but I want you to think about that. Think about the way your experiences, good and bad, influenced you for good or for bad. And when I say bad, it doesn't have to be some terrible catastrophic thing, but it can be a situation where, let's say, you lied, you told a lie. Well, if you go back and think about it, why did you lie? Were you lying to protect your reputation? Were you lying because you thought you'd get fired? Maybe lying about why you were late or whatever. Did you lie because you were doing something that you didn't want anybody to know about? Think about those things. Really take an honest look. And I know it's hard. Like, nobody really wants to do this stuff. But you can find a lot of clues when you take an honest look at this, because if you have done something in the past that you're not proud of, okay, who hasn't, first of all? You know, we've all done things that we wish we hadn't done, or we think about it later and we think, oh, I could have done this. It actually would have been better. It would have been easier, whatever. If we look, take a minute and really honestly look back at those things and then ask ourselves, what could I have done differently? What could I have done that might have given me a different result, a better result, or whatever? If we think about the way those experiences changed us, so in the example of we did something that we wish we hadn't done, or you know, that we're ashamed of, if we are carrying around some level of guilt or shame about it, this is a great opportunity for you to hit the reset button and say, okay, you know what? I did this thing. I wish I hadn't done it. I'm sorry I did it. I'm embarrassed about it. But you know what? That was me then. And this is me today. And I'm not going to ever do that again. And if you think about how that thing that you wish you hadn't done made you feel, you can really solidify this in your mind that I don't ever want to feel that way again. I never want to have the anxiety associated with that again, or the worry, the fear, the anger, losing somebody else's trust, whatever it was. Okay. And by doing that, you're telling yourself, no, we're not doing that again. You're changing the trajectory of your own life. And if you don't do that kind of thing with things that you wish you hadn't done, then you're very likely to repeat them. Because the way that we perceive ourselves is the way that we will behave. So let's say in the example of a lie, if you lied in the past and you got away with it, I actually don't think any of us ever gets away with anything long-term. Everything always comes out. But nevertheless, if you feel like for the time being that, you know, you got away with it, and but it's in you. You know the truth. So now you know that you're a liar. And what do? Liars lie. So your self-perception will be that you lie. And then, you know, none of us wants to think terribly of ourselves, although sadly, a lot of people do. It's amazing to me how many people say, I hate my life, or I hate myself. But if we think of ourselves as liars, and, you know, we do whatever it takes to, you know, get by, and that includes unethical, immoral, even illegal stuff, then we will do those things, because liars lie, cheaters cheat, stealers steal. Okay. But if you say, no, that's not me anymore, and you make that decision, you are far less likely to go to an unethical, immoral, or illegal way of handling a challenge, an obstacle, a problem, something painful. You know, you just won't use those wrong things to cope anymore, or to get through anymore. Okay. I want you to think about what you learned through these events of your life that have influenced you, the things that you can recall. And this is kind of a lifelong thing. I mean, I don't expect anybody to sit down and, you know, take the next 30 days and get off the merry-go-round of life and do nothing but this. Although it's kind of a fun thing if you do have an opportunity to go on vacation or go on a retreat or something like that, where you can just really delve into your authentic identity. You will find your purpose. When you find yourself, you find your purpose. But this is a lifelong thing. You can do this for 5 minutes every morning. You can do it at night before you go to bed. You can fit it in between things. But think about the things that you learned about others, about yourself, about the way things happen in life, about the way the world works. This is your perspective and where your perspective came from. If you think about and ask yourself, what did I learn from every important event that you can remember in your life? And you can break it down by, okay, well, when I was a little kid, what did I learn about people? What did I learn about myself? What did I learn about the world? Okay, when I was a teenager, and on in the different, you can say, the different places of your life. So what did I learn from my family? What did I learn from my neighborhood? What did I learn from teachers? What did I learn from friends of the family, extended family? What did I learn at church? Whatever. And write these things down. Things will come up to you that you haven't thought about for a long time. And they can be stepping stones, if you will, on the path toward finding and living your purpose. Because the things that you remember, the people you remember, the words that were said, the attitudes, the actions, those things that really stand out to you are clues. They're big clues to who you are and what's important to you. And who you are and what's important to you is the foundation to your purpose. The next one, list the abilities you acquired or developed in each of those things that you can remember. And this can go back to being a little kid. It can be, you know, yesterday. One of the things that I thought about, that I hadn't thought about forever, in thinking about what I was going to talk about in this podcast, what aspect of finding your purpose now have I not already talked about? And I was thinking about a crazy thing that happened. It's like 100 years ago. It's so bizarre to me that it came up. But as I was thinking about, you know, encouraging you to examine your life and really take the time to think about the times that influenced you, the people, the words, the attitudes, the actions, all of it, this thing came to my mind. And it was a time when I was in elementary school. I think I was maybe in fifth or sixth grade. And it was a Friday afternoon, which is important because the school was going to be closed all weekend. And I was a very gawky looking white kid. And I was like the only white kid for a million miles in any direction. And I mean whiter than white, with blonde hair and blue eyes. You could, my people have teased me when I was younger about you could see me from outer space. So this group of girls kind of jumped me in the hallway. And there were too many of them. I was easily overpowered. And they were beating on me. And they pulled me into, it was like an equipment room. They called it the ballroom. And they pulled me into that room and they were just beating on me. And somebody said, you know, oh, somebody's coming. We got to go. And they ran out and they left me in the room and they closed the door. And the door locked. And it was the kind of lock that required a key from both sides. So I was locked in the ballroom, the equipment room at Upland Elementary School after school had let out. And I was screaming and I was terrified. It was dark. I don't know why I didn't turn the light on, if I couldn't find the light switch or whatever, but I was completely stunned and I had been completely overwhelmed by these girls. And nobody knew at that time that I had a horrific home life. And all I could think of in that dark ballroom, in addition to that I was literally physically hurting from being beat up by, I don't know how many of them there were a lot. All I could think of was, when I finally do get out of here, my grandfather is going to beat the stuffing out of me, and I'm scared he's going to kill me. I was always afraid he was going to kill me. And I thought about, why did I think about that? Out of the clear blue, I haven't thought about it in 100 years. Thankfully, I'll tell you the end of the story. I'm in there and I'm banging, pounding on the door and I'm screaming and I'm hoping I can get somebody's attention before the school is completely locked up and everybody's completely gone for the weekend. And I think it was a janitor who heard me and opened up the door. And I was late getting home, and I did get beat when I got home because I was late. And why that came up to me, I thought, this is so bizarre. I literally haven't thought about that in years. But this is the kind of thing that I'm encouraging you to do. When you let yourself, when you let your mind really wander, and I'm not sure we do that enough, but go back to situations in our lives and think about, okay, what did I learn? Well, I learned to be very diligent about looking over my shoulder to make sure that I wasn't going to get jumped by a group of girls ever again, or that if I did, I would, you know, be hopefully better prepared and not allow anybody to just, without a sound coming out of my mouth, drag me into a room and lock me in there. I didn't scream. I didn't yell for help. I was just quiet. That made me think, all the dysfunction at home and the abuse at home had sort of trained me to quietly absorb whatever was coming my way. I learned early on with my abusers that if I cried and begged and pleaded, it went on longer. And if I stood stoically and I refuse to cry, if I just set my jaw and just stared, it would end. But that didn't serve me very well with that group of girls who pulled me into the equipment room. Because I just took it. I didn't cry out until they were gone, and I knew they were gone. I heard them go down the hallway, and I made sure they were all the way gone before I started screaming and pounding on the door. I realize now, here I am, literally decades after this situation, thinking about this. One of the things I learned about myself is that I used to take whatever pain came my way. I would just take it. I wouldn't complain. This was later on at work, on my job, getting passed over for promotions, for example, you know, not getting the same bonus as the other people. I have to say they were all men. I was in a male-dominated industry in the 70s and 80s and, well, my whole life. But, you know, I started my own company as a result of all that. But I didn't, I just took situations that came at me without complaint. And by looking at that, I realized that I was able to change that about myself. And make a decision, I'm not doing that anymore. I'm not going to stand quietly like a sheep being led to the slaughter. And furthermore, I'm not going to stand by and let anybody else get hurt. And I realize now, looking back at all that, that there was a moment in time that I decided to be an advocate for others and for myself, to speak up, stand up for myself, but to also speak up and stand up for all the people who didn't or couldn't stand up for themselves. And isn't it so bizarre that all of this, for me, in my mind, in my way of thinking, goes back to the day, Friday afternoon, in, what was it? It would have been like the late 60s, long time ago, that I got jumped by a group of girls. Well, that's just one story, you know, of a million stories of mine. You have a million stories too. But I hope that helps you to see through to the purpose of what I'm asking you to do. Thinking about what happened to you and how it made you feel and how it changed you, what you learned about other people, about yourself, about the way things happen. Sometimes tremendously unfair things happen. We know that. I didn't deserve to be jumped that day. I didn't deserve any of the nonsense I had as a child. But all of it informs my perspective today. It informs who I am today. It informs the advocacy that I've done for years with children who are too little and too vulnerable to advocate for themselves. So I want to know your stories. If you do this, if you examine your life and you find something that you can say, ah, interesting, that was a turning point for me. That led me to think this way. That led me to feel this way. That led me to be like this. I want to hear about it. Those are the ways. I mean, it's very practical stuff that I'm talking about, and I hope I'm not boring you with this. I'm hoping that as a result of kind of rooting around in your past and pulling things out and really kind of looking at them, that not that you will feel the pain all over again, look at them in an objective way, because you are who you are now. You're older, you're more mature, you're not vulnerable anymore. You can look at something that happened to you, like that group of girls is nowhere around anymore. They can't hurt me. And I am much more defended now than I ever was then. But it informed me and changed me. These things have informed you and changed you. And I'm going to say, in a lot of ways, these things have changed us for the good. And if they haven't, if you find that something changed you for not so good, let's go back to the first part that we were talking about, where you look back and say, oh, I lied about this. Well, why? Oh, because I was ashamed about it. Oh, well, when I was a kid, I lied and said my mother was a movie star and she's shooting a movie somewhere. I had so many stories about why my parents weren't there in my life. Why? Because I was ashamed. I thought if somebody knew that my parents didn't want me, they wouldn't want to be friends with me either. Nobody wanted me around. So yeah, I lied. Well, in facing up to some of those kinds of things, if you do find something negative about yourself that you don't like, first of all, like I said before, that was then, this is now. But the other thing is, let yourself a break. Give yourself some mercy. Forgive yourself. Maybe you did the best you knew how to do with what you knew at that time. Let it go. Give yourself some mercy. Okay. Couple more things. List the abilities that you acquired or developed. Did you learn to speak up for yourself? Did you learn to take care of somebody else? Did you learn a practical thing? Like, okay, well, you learned how to do accounting. You learned how to balance your checkbook, whatever it was. Think about the abilities that you acquired and developed. I've talked before about, I've written a book about the character traits that you developed that have helped you through your life. Think about those. I'm talking about resilience, resourcefulness, tenacity, being perseverant, being determined. There are so many, and I wrote about them in my book, Successful Survivors, the 8 character traits of successful survivors and how you can get them. They're actually 15 character traits that are pretty common, 8 that are almost universal. List the personality traits that you acquired or that were honed in you. So it can be, for example, your sense of humor. Maybe one of the coping skills that you've used in your life has been to crack a joke when things are tense and to try to lighten the mood. Maybe you're really good at redirecting the conversation when things are, that you sense that things are going sideways. Those things, like reading a room, like knowing who you should trust or not trust, those kinds of things. And finally, list your coping skills. Think about the ways that you've coped and what's worked for you. And think about what hasn't worked for you. I mean, you know, if you have one of the ways that you've coped in the past is to eat a gallon of ice cream, you know, and then you gain weight or you get diabetes or whatever, some other health problem, I would say, okay, that's a coping skill, but it's not healthy and it's not working for you because it's not good for you and it's not sustainable. And so again, when you look at these things, you can say, helps in the moment, but it makes it worse later on. I'm going to stop. That was then. This is now. I'm making some changes in my life. And that's how it's done. When you sort through the things that, the memories that pop up, and you think about what you learned, it changes your perspective about any ugly or embarrassing or shameful feelings about that thing. And it's not all negative either. I mean, if you think about, okay, well, you won the spelling bee when you were in second grade or whatever. And how did that feel? And that was great. And what did you learn? Oh, you learned that you're pretty good with spelling and maybe with etymology and maybe you're a word person. And so whatever you learned from the good thing, from the bad thing, from the seemingly inconsequential thing, pay attention to those things. Because those are the threads that weave the fabric that's you. And when you become really, really in touch with who you really are, and you embrace yourself, good, bad, ugly, scarred, broken. If you just embrace yourself, you will enjoy your life more. You'll be more at peace. You'll have more joy. You'll be modeling that really good behavior of accepting yourself for everybody within your influence. You'll be showing them how it's done. And when you do that, and you really just embrace who you are, and you're happy with who you are, and you don't feel like you have to change yourself or anybody else, your purpose will appear and become clear to you. So thank you for joining me this week. I hope you come back next week. Go back and listen to the other, gosh, I think we're on 112 or 113 episodes. There are a lot of old episodes that have a lot of good clues in them about your purpose. And it's worth doing, let me tell you, because living without purpose leads to misery. It just does. And I mean, there's nothing wrong with taking an antidepressant or, you know, whatever you have to do. But I think that instead of automatically just taking a pill, when we peel back the layers on who we are and get okay with ourselves, maybe some of that stuff is not needed. Maybe the unhealthy coping skills will no longer be needed. Maybe you'll be healthier, feel better, feel more contented than you ever have in your life. Because with your purpose comes a sense of contentedness that you can't get any other way. I'd love to hear from you. Send me a message or a voice note. And I'll see you next week.